And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was now expecting a child.
And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them.
That night, there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified.
But the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. He will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger."
Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased."
When the angels had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." Then they hurried to the village and found Mary and Joseph lying, and there lying in the manger was the baby.
After seeing him, the shepherds told everyone what had happened and what the angel had said to them about this child. All who heard the shepherds' story was astonished. The shepherds went back to their flocks, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen. It was just as the angel had told them.
So like the shepherds, let us all praise and adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come. choirs of angels singing exaltation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For he alone is worthy.
Hallelujah. 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 Man, that was good.
Yes, sir.
Man, that was real good.
Yes,
good job, y'all. Good job, whole kids. Wow.
Hallelujah.
That was a beautiful, beautiful presentation. Amen.
Amen.
God is so good. God is so good. How many of y'all excited to be in the house today?
Amen.
Come on, I said, how many of y'all excited to be in the house today? God is good, y'all. He is so, so, so good. I'm telling you, I told you last week, this is the most wonderful time of the year. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so we are excited about you and you being here. We're excited about what we believe God is doing in your life.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. I say what God is doing in your life.
Amen.
Some people say, well, I don't know what he's doing. Trust me, he's doing something good.
Amen.
Whatever he's doing is good. I said, it's good, Brother DePlessy. It's good. Somebody say, it's good.
It's good.
Amen. Hello, 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 hello. Amen. God is good. Y'all, I'm excited. I'm excited. Amen. Let me slow down. Amen. As Pastor said, let me slow down a second. I won't get too ahead of myself. I just want to say good morning and welcome to everybody who is here as well as to those who are joining us via Facebook and now we got Instagram, and now we got TikTok, and now we got all of it. Amen. Our social media is leveling up. Amen. Glory be to God. We got the Wolf family helping us with social media now.
Amen.
It's a team effort over there. Amen. And so we thank God for them. Amen. Amen. And so if this is your first time here at church or joining us online, I'm Pastor Daniel. And on behalf of our senior pastors, Pastor David and Pastor Veronica, we want to let you know that we are glad that you are here. Amen. We welcome you here. We hope you feel welcome. We hope you feel the love. Amen. Yeah, amen. And we just want to say that if you're local, we'd love to have you and your family come and join us every Sunday at 10 a.m. Amen. I tell you, God is doing something wonderful at the Whole Family Church, and we would love for you to be a part of it. Amen. And so we're going to ask that you would, if you're watching online, that you would do a couple of things. Do a couple of things. We want you to hit the like button. Matter of fact, if you're on Facebook, hit it a bunch of times. If you're on YouTube, you can subscribe and also hit the like button. And then follow us across all social media. Amen. We, like I said, we're even on TikTok now. So we got the young, the Gen Z generation going to be coming to the church. Amen? Amen. Glory to God. So we're excited about what God is doing. Now, like I said earlier, y'all, our whole kids did such a great job. And y'all, I'm excited because, you know, we're getting them right out the womb. I said right out the womb. Growing up whole. Raising up a generation for Jesus. And y'all, with your help, I believe we can have one of the most exciting, cutting-edge children's churches in the state of Louisiana. How many of y'all believe that? I believe that. And so what we want to do is believe God for a building for our kids. Y'all went quiet on that. I said for a building for our kids. Come on, I know y'all not no small thinkers out there, huh? I said a whole building just for the kids. Amen. Volunteers who are going to serve with excellence. Yeah. Come on. Amen. And an increase in our giving so we can make it state of the art. Yeah. Somebody say amen to that. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Yes. Y'all, if you haven't heard already, 2023 is our year, our time, our moment to do what?
Level up.
Somebody say level up.
Level up.
And y'all, that word level up, it means to come up higher. It means to improve. It means to increase. Somebody say increase.
Increase.
Amen. And I believe that as we improve and come up higher and as we increase, that God will put an anointing on us, the anointing for divine distinction. Somebody say divine distinction. And what is that? That's when God graces you to stand out so that you can stand up. Stand up for what? Stand up for righteousness. Stand up for holiness. Stand up for the kingdom of God. Somebody say the kingdom of God. Where are my hope dealers at? Come on, where are my hope dealers? Make some noise if you're a hope dealer. Keep quiet if you're a dope dealer. Amen. Amen. We're going to get you saved by the end of the service. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I see within all of you believers, I see an unorthodox genealogy. Yes, if you don't know what that is, go back two services and you'll find out that you, as a believer, have an unorthodox genealogy. Amen. Yes, yes, yes. God is so good. 1 Peter 2:9 says you're a chosen generation. Come on, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own special people. Amen? Yes. And so, again, last week we talked about, we leveled up our joy. How many of y'all remember that? We leveled up in the area of joy, and we found out that joy and happiness are two very different things. Somebody say they're two different things. And we found out that we don't have to be happy to experience joy. Amen? Joy is always before us if we would just reach for it. Somebody say reach for joy. Amen. And so I'm excited about our subject today. We're going to go to the next phase of this, as today is Christmas Eve. Man, it's Christmas. Tomorrow is Christmas, y'all. My goodness. Yes, and then the day after is Miss Sheila's birthday. Amen. Happy birthday, Miss Sheila. Amen. Glory to God. But today we're going to be talking about level up your Christmas. Wise men still seek him. Somebody say, wise men still seek him. Get your Bible in your hands and let's make this bold Bible confession. Say this with me. Say, this is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. And I can do what it says I can do. This morning, I will be taught the word of God. I boldly say, my mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I thank you, Father, that I am a hearer and a doer of the word. And after hearing the word, I'll never be the same. I'll never be the same in Jesus' name. Favor, increase, and promotion are in my life now. Amen.
Glory to God.
Now we're going to do some reading out of the book of Matthew, chapter 2. And I want you to just follow along with me. It's 12 verses, so we're not going to read it together, but I want you to follow along as we read and just stay engaged. Amen. Don't tune out. Amen. Glory to God. We're going somewhere today. I say we're going somewhere today.
Amen.
Amen. So let's read Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. And so they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who shall shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the young child." Somebody say, "The young child." "And when you have found him, bring word back to me, that I may come and worship him also." And when they heard the king, they departed. And behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. Amen. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child and his mother and Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then, being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Y'all, Every year, without fail, there is much debate around this time regarding Christmas. Yes. People come out of the woodworks with their facts and their figures to tell us how Christmas should or should not be celebrated. Oftentimes, these people are not even Christians. Mm-hmm. But they want to tell Christians about Christmas. People love to fight and to debate and to argue. Anybody know that's true? Was it on December 25th or was it not? Were there two or three donkeys in the stable? What kind of hay was Jesus laying on? Did the wise men wrap the gifts or not? Did they just leave them plain? Now, most of it is much ado about nothing. Or to say it plainly, it's just noise. And of course, we should always just ignore the noise. But there's also a few things that could probably use some clarity. For instance, in the nativity scene, there are some things that are traditional, but they're not biblically accurate. For instance, the shepherds and the wise men did not visit baby Jesus at the same time. And yet, when we look at the nativity scene, they're always all together. Jesus was not a baby in the manger when the wise men arrived. He was around 2 years old. The Bible says he was a young child. Somebody say young child.
Young child.
Also, There weren't necessarily just three wise men. Could have been two, could have been 20. It doesn't say. They just presented three types of gifts. And so we said it was three. So we look at them, we say, well, it's three because it's three gifts. And also, we like that three because it sounds good in the song. We three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts, we've traveled so far, right? And so we just kind of go with it, amen? But here's the thing, and this is what's most important and the thing that we have to remember as believers. Whether there was three wise men or 30, no matter the type or texture of the hay in the manger, whether the wise men came from the east of Jerusalem or New Orleans east, the bottom line is Jesus was born. Amen. Oh, y'all didn't hear what I said. I said the bottom line is Jesus, the Christ, was born. Can I get an amen on that? I said, can I get an amen on that? And his birth is cause for great celebration. Great celebration. You know, Christmas literally means Christ mass, celebration of Christ, a mass for Christ. We come around the Savior. We gather to celebrate his birth. But how many of you know, y'all, not everybody was celebrating Christ then, and not everybody is celebrating Christ now. Amen. I want us to take a look at this passage from Matthew chapter 2. And I want to break it down. We're going to go through verse by verse so we can get a better understanding of the celebration of Christ. And while we do it, I want you to see that there are three primary characters in this story that are still prevalent amongst us today. Number one is the wise men. Somebody say the wise men. Number two is King Herod. Somebody say King Herod.
King Herod.
And number three, the chief priests and scribes. Y'all, it's time to level up our Christmas.
Yeah.
Y'all ready to go?
Yeah.
I say, you ready to go?
Amen.
All right, let's go. In verse number one, the Bible says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. Now, y'all, isn't it interesting that the Bible says that the prophecy was told that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem? Y'all, literally that Bethlehem, that word means the house of bread. Isn't it something that Jesus said, I'm the bread of life? So the bread of life was born in the house of bread. Right. Amen, amen, yeah. All right, let's keep going, yeah. Not enough revelation for you. All right, amen, we're gonna keep going. Now he said that he was born in the east, right? I'm sorry, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem. And they said, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. The first characters I want you to see here are the wise men. As I was studying this, I ran across something very interesting, which makes our Level Up series that we've been teaching all year long come full circle today. If you recall, in January of this year, we began the series in the book of Daniel. My favorite book. And we saw that 600 years before Christ was born, the Hebrews had been taken into captivity in Babylon. Y'all, Babylon was east of Jerusalem. Oh, we going somewhere today, y'all.
Amen.
So these wise men were likely in Babylon when they saw this star. At that time, Babylon may have been a center of Jewish learning. And this is where wise men like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would have been as advisors in the court. Y'all remember the series?
Yeah.
They were literate. They were scientific men. They were learned men. They studied astronomy for signs in the sky and determining the times and seasons of the holy days. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Those that were mentioned in the scripture. This also suggests that the wise men were likely Jewish. Reading about the Messiah in Jewish texts, particularly in the Old Testament and in Isaiah. They were learned men, and they were likely very wealthy men as well.
Yeah.
Probably very well known and very well respected in their hometown.
Yeah.
And these men thought it wise, they thought it prudent to seek God.
Yeah.
spoiler alert, it is still wise, it is still prudent to see God.
Amen.
Somebody say amen to that.
Amen.
And then the amazing story of the wise men ties right in to our faith series. Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is. And that he is a rewarder of those who diligently do what?
Seek him.
That diligently do what?
Seek him.
Seek him. Diligently seek him.
Yes.
These wise men were diligent in their search for Jesus. Yes. And their search for the Christ. They weren't just seeking a baby. They were seeking the Messiah.
Amen.
The promised one. The one who would save the world. They were seeking God, y'all. And they were inquiring about him. They wanted to know more about him. They were proactive about it. Somebody say proactive.
Amen.
Nobody had to force them to seek God. It came out of their own hearts. You know, so many people these days, I see it on posts, and people post it all the time, and they say it, they quote it. They love talking about Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. To give you future, a future, and a hope. And I thank God for that. That's good, right? But you got to keep on reading. You got to get to the next verse. As a matter of fact, the next verse is 12 and 13 says, then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me. Somebody say, seek me.
Seek me.
And find me. Somebody say, find me. When you search for me with all your heart. Somebody say, all your heart.
All your heart.
Somebody say, all your heart.
All your heart.
So many people told me that they tried God. Anybody ever told you that? Oh, I tried that. I tried that.
Yeah.
Or they were in church and they didn't feel anything or nothing happened. And so they become a skeptic. And some even become heretics. We ain't going to go there today. But they never considered that maybe, just maybe, the reason you haven't found him is you ain't looking hard enough. God wants us to search for him with our whole heart. Somebody say our whole heart. You know, it's funny. You know, we'll give God that little lackadaisical search, but let us lose them keys, though. I bet you're going to search for them keys with your whole heart. Up and down every nook and cranny. You're going to turn that house upside down looking for them keys. We were in New York a few weeks ago, and it was the last day, and Ethan had wanted to go to the Statue of Liberty, Lady Liberty, he called. And we were doing good. We were ahead of schedule. We on purpose said we're not going to do much this morning so that way we can get out on time and have no pressure.
All right.
And here we go. All right, it's time to leave. Where's the keys? Lisa, you had the keys. No, Danny, you had the keys. No, I'm pretty sure you had the keys.
Yeah.
No, I'm pretty sure you had the keys. I put the keys right over here. No, you didn't. That. Y'all know how that goes, right? Amen.
Amen.
And so now the search is on. The search is on. And we begin to look high and low, up and down. When I tell you every corner of that place, Lisa had already packed. I felt bad for her. She had already packed the whole everything because we was leaving the next day. She packed everything. Y'all, she pulled everything out. She wanted to make sure it wasn't rolled up in one of the shirts or nothing like that. We were searching and seeking. I said, okay, let me go back to the car. I went back to the car, looked in the car. The car was locked. The car can't lock itself, right?
Right.
So I must have took the keys with me. So that means it's got to be in the hotel room.
Exactly.
I go back to the hotel room. We searching more. Got Daniel searching. Got Ethan searching. Even Micaiah is searching. Crawl in the room, high and low, being diligent about our search.
Yeah.
I said, Holy Ghost, I stopped. I said, okay, I got to go back. I got to go with what I know. Yeah. Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
I should have did that first. Yeah. I should have done that first. Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Show me where them keys are, Lord.
Yeah.
And y'all, no, it was not in my pocket, Ms. Sheila. In my pocket. A flash came before my eyes, and I saw where I put the keys.
Wow.
In the car, in a certain little spot, And what's funny is I told Lisa, okay, we're going to start putting it here so we don't forget the keys. Changed my routine and look at what happened. But anyway, I'll go back to the car and sure enough, there go them keys. Y'all, see, losing the keys meant that we were stuck. It meant we couldn't go anywhere. How many of you know in life, without God, you're going to be stuck? You're not going to be able to go anywhere. That's why you got to seek him. That's why you got to make sure you do it with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. You got to want God. They got anybody here who wants God? Come on, somebody. We've gotten into this comfortable place where we just, if I feel like it. Everything is just based on all these feelings. What if God did that with us? What if the next breath you breathe was just based on just some random feeling he might have? Yo, we have got to come to a place where we are, especially as believers, that we are seeking God with everything. That he is our top priority. Somebody say my top priority. The wise men, y'all, they sought God on their own. Nobody had to force them to do this. They were looking for the Messiah. They were looking for this Christ. As believers, we got to do a better job of being proactive when it comes to the things of God. How many of you know nobody should have to prime you to praise? Nobody should have to prompt you to pray. They shouldn't have to force you to fast or motivate you to meditate. These are an ordinary part of the lifestyle of the believer, which is the lifestyle of faith. Because faith is a... Oh, boy, I see we got to do a whole lot of review. Faith is a... That's why I need Brother Spears. Brother Spears, no. Amen. Faith is a lifestyle. The wise men, y'all, came from far distances to see Jesus. Some of us have a hard time coming down the street to get to church. Oh, Lord, where's my help today? I need an organ, Jesus. And don't bring up the fact that they brought gifts and treasures to Jesus. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Some people are so tight in church. They hold on to a quarter and squeeze a book out of George Washington's nose. Just holding on to it. Man, I can't release it. Yo, in 2024 and beyond, we got to do better. Yeah. Somebody say better. Yeah. Somebody say, I'm going to do better. We all can do better. Yeah. We all can. All of us can. Yeah. We can do better. And you know what I love is God is so patient with us. Yeah. He's so merciful. He's so loving. He's so kind. You know, right now we're at the end process of potty training Micaiah. And, you know, and every now and then, just out of the blue, she would just, you know, wet herself. I'm like, Micaiah, why? And then we had this whole conversation about why she did it. And she look around and she's doing all of this stuff and, you know, just trying to give me an explanation as to why. You know, there's no good explanation. There is no good explanation, Micaiah. You know what to do. What are you, come on. But every time, y'all, as long as she tells me she gonna do better, my mercy endures forever. All of a sudden, it just hit me a certain way. I'm sorry, Daddy. I'm sorry. All of a sudden, my mercy endures forever. All of the anger I felt. So I gotta change one of these diapers in the middle of a restaurant somewhere, you know. We shouldn't have, you know, because you're supposed to know how to, come on now. All of that goes away, and my mercy comes up, and I realize, oh, she's just a baby. It's all right. It's all right. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. That's my baby. That's how God is with us. He's, you know, you just, you know, when you got to do better, just say, Lord, just have mercy on me. Have mercy on me, Lord. I'm going to do better. I'm going to do better, Lord. I'm going to seek you better, Lord. In 2024, y'all, we are going, in this house, we are going to be diligent about seeking the Lord with our whole heart. Come on, how many of y'all agree with that? Yeah. Somebody say, with my whole heart.
My whole heart.
Wise men still seek him. The next character in the story we want to look at is King Herod. verse 3, the Bible says, when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled. Somebody say troubled. And all Jerusalem with him. Of course, this giant turkey was troubled. He felt his position was being threatened. Of course, he was troubled.
Yes, yes.
Where is he born king of the Jews? Yes. And who was Herod? He was the king. Yeah. So you telling me they got another king that's coming up? Oh, no. I can't have that. I can't have that. I can't. No. See, King Herod represents the world and the world system. That wants nothing to do with God. It wants nothing to do with God. And as a matter of fact, it wants to eliminate God. It wants to eliminate the thought of God. Well, y'all act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about right now. Don't y'all know we live in a world right now that wants to eliminate God? Eliminate the very thought of God? The very mention of Jesus? That's the world we're living in right now. When you threaten the system,
come on.
The system comes after you.
Yeah. Wow.
King Herod was the system. He represented the system of that time.
Amen.
You don't know that you threaten the system come after you. You don't know that. Ask MLK.
Come on.
Ask Malcolm, Brother Malcolm.
Yeah.
Ask JFK.
Mm-hmm.
Ask Fred Hampton. They found out when you threaten the system don't like that too much. I want to tell you a story. I make sure I don't name no names, don't say nothing. But there was somebody, I'm going to just say it like this. There was somebody who was running for office locally. Let me not give too much information. And they was running that they was going to make a lot of change. And they was going to do all these different things and what have you. And y'all, they actually won. They actually won. And when they got in office, they got a phone call one day from a private number. And all the voice on the other line said it was, if you mess with the system gonna mess with you. And y'all, they didn't say mess. I'm gonna let y'all go ahead and figure out what they really said. See, the system doesn't, it don't like being messed with. It don't like being shaken up. So when the threat of this other king is coming up, now Herod is getting nervous. He's getting nervous. He said, oh, no, I got to do something about this. And y'all, do y'all know that Herod went and actually had every child under 2 years old slaughtered to try to take out this king? And I'm telling you that now because we're not going to get to that part today. But you got to understand that's how much of a threat Jesus and his kingdom was and is to the world system, y'all. Y'all, the good news of the gospel is bad news for the systems of the world. Let me say that again. The good news of the gospel is bad news for the systems of this world. Why? Because it's not just the gospel of salvation. It's also the gospel of the kingdom of God. And the scripture tells us that his kingdom, there shall be no end. Somebody say, no end.
No end.
Daniel put it like this in chapter 2, verse 44. He said, and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. Oh, I wish I had some people in the kingdom. Which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these other kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Do I have any kingdom people in the house today? I said, do I have any kingdom in the house today? There will be no end of his kingdom. Unpack your bags, y'all. Some of y'all so ready. Y'all so ready to just fly on out to heaven. I'll fly away, oh glory. You just ready to just fly on out. And I understand. I get it. I get it, I understand. But y'all, we have work to do.
Yeah.
Now, in this time, Jesus told us to occupy until I come.
Yeah.
What does occupy mean? It means to do business.
Yeah.
When Jesus went up in the book of Acts, when he went up into heaven, the Bible says that the disciples were watching and they were looking up. And while they were watching him ascend into heaven, an angel appeared and said, why stand you here looking up? Didn't he tell you to go and do something?
Yeah.
Didn't he tell you to occupy? And what are we doing 2,000 years later? Looking up, waiting for him to come back. Any moment. Now, come on, come on, Jesus. I'm saved. I don't know about all these other wicked people, but I'm saved. Come get me. Me and my four and no more. We got to do better, y'all. I said, we got to do better, y'all. Amen. Oh, we're going to get us an organ in 2024, boy. We ain't going to have no quiet spots. Soon as y'all get quiet, the organ going to hit it. Boom! The hammering, that's right. Amen. Glory to God. Y'all, the kingdom that we are a part of will never be destroyed. It will never end. It will stand forever. And that is a threat, y'all, to the systems of this world. And so they will do all they can to try and silence you and try to silence the gospel. They'll kick you off social media if they got to. They'll block your page if they got to. They'll limit the reach of your post if they got to. Why? Because it's about another kingdom. You don't want you talking about that other kingdom. Don't be bringing that up. Don't y'all be talking about that. Why? That kingdom, y'all, is a threat and it's about to take over. Y'all, it's takeover time. I said it's takeover time. It's takeover time. Take over what? Take over the media. Take over governments. Take over school boards. Take over the Fortune 500.
Yeah.
Y'all not scared, huh?
No.
Come on, y'all not scared of these systems, are you?
No, sir. No, sir.
It's takeover time.
Amen.
Somebody say takeover.
Takeover.
If you will stand in what I'm telling you today, God will put, I told you, he will put an anointing on you. He will put a grace on you that will cause you to stand out. And whatever field, whatever lane that you are in, your lane don't have to be somebody else's lane. God will cause a divine distinction to be on you. Somebody say on me. Now, y'all, there's one more group of characters that we got to talk about. And that's the chief priests and the scribes. Somebody say the chief priests and the scribes. Verse 4 says, and when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. And so they said to him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, but you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not the least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler who shall shepherd my people. The religious leaders knew the prophecies, and they could even tell Herod where the Messiah was to be born. But yet they still didn't go to Bethlehem. I want you to think about that. They knew the prophecies. They knew where the Messiah was going to be born. Hold on. Stop acting crazy. They knew where he was going to be born, but yet they still didn't go to Bethlehem. Y'all, this group right here, this is the danger zone. This is the danger zone. Why are they the danger zone? Because these are the religious people. These are the religious people. See, the religious people, they know about God. They know about God, but they don't know God. How many of you know that's two very different things? I say that's two very, very different things. They knew all about where the Christ was to be born, but they knew nothing about him actually having been born. My goodness. Be careful, believers. Be careful. We should never want to come to the point where we think we know it all. You should never say things like, I'm good when it comes to God. No, you're not good. Especially if you grew up in the church. Especially if you grew up in the church. There was a greater danger for you. Amen? Why? Because of familiarity. See, it's easy to become familiar with God and familiar with the things of God. Familiar with the pastor. Familiar with praise and worship.
Yeah.
Familiar with prayer. Just familiar.
Come on.
And familiarity breeds contempt.
Yeah.
It makes you indifferent about God. How many know that's a terrible place to be? I never want to come to a place that I am indifferent about God.
Yeah.
We sing the songs. We pray the prayers. We might even give a little, but yet our heart far from God. Isaiah 29, 13 says it like this. Therefore, the Lord said, inasmuch as these people draw near with their mouths and honor me with their lips, but have removed their what? Their hearts far from me. And their fear toward me is taught by the commandment of men. Taught by the commandment of men. And we know, what does that mean? As, you know, we know when to say amen. We know when to shout. We know when to clap. But y'all, that's not the fear of the Lord. That's not the fear of the Lord. We must have a holy reverence for God even when nobody is around. Even when nobody is looking. You gotta have, that's gotta come from the inside of you. Amen?
Yes, yes.
God should never be common to us. The Holy Spirit is not your buddy. He's not your genie.
No, sir. No.
He is God. You gotta put some respect on his name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Y'all, how many of you know the word of God is inexhaustible? We gotta put some respect on the word of God.
Amen.
It's the bread of life.
Yes.
It can't go stale. If anything is stale, it's us.
Amen.
We get stale to the word. Amen.
Amen.
Don't get common with the word. Don't get common, y'all, with any of the sacred things that God has given his body. If we do so, we run the risk of being just like these chief priests and scribes. They know all about the Lord, but they didn't seek the Lord. They didn't seek the Lord. We got to understand the importance of not just knowing about Christ, but actively seeking a relationship with Christ.
Amen.
I will tell you the best thing I believe that our parents did in raising us in the admonition of the Lord, the best thing that they did was they taught us to have a relationship with God.
Yes, yes, yes.
That one thing, if you can manage that,
yes,
you're going to be on a good track. Your child will be on a very good track in life. Because now if I got a relationship with God, now I don't have to watch every single thing that they're doing all the time trying to helicopter parent them. Because I know they got the Holy Ghost on the inside of them.
Amen.
They have a relationship with God. They want to do the right thing because it's the right thing.
Amen.
They want to live holy because they want to live holy.
Yeah.
It don't have to be force. It don't have to be, I'm going to make you do it. If you get you develop a relationship with God, I'm telling you, there is no stopping you.
Amen.
There is no stopping you. The trajectory that you will be on, your child will be on, will be up, up, and up. Somebody say up. Amen.
Preach.
Wise men still seek him. Verse 7 says, then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, go and search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may also come and worship him. And when they heard the king, they departed. And behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. Somebody say great joy.
Great joy.
Joy to the world, y'all.
Yeah.
We learned last week that we can have joy even when in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of pain, when we don't have happiness, we can still have joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. No matter what we face, the Holy Spirit is with us at all times. The Holy Spirit is with us, he is in us, and he is for us. Now let's wrap up. The Bible says in verse 11, and when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. What did they do? They worshiped him. So he's not just any king. He's not just any king. You know, if you were Jewish, you don't just worship anybody. You only worship God. So they recognized that he was not only a king, he was God. They worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Y'all, the significance of these three types of gifts. Gold has always been a symbol of wealth and kingship. Gold is a gift for Jesus, symbolizes his kingship, and it acknowledges his divine royalty. Frankincense was used in Jewish worship as a fragrant offering. It's used in worship, and so it suggests Jesus' priestly role and his divinity. And finally, myrrh was commonly used in embalming and as an anointing oil. The gift of myrrh foreshadowed Jesus' suffering and his death, as myrrh was associated with their burial practices. Amen. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. It was no accident, amen? And then verse 12 says, then being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. How many of y'all thank God for another way? Boy, God will make a way out of no way. Come on, I said God knows how to make a way out of no way. God will preserve your life. He can make a way out of no way. I'm going to send you another way. I know them people after you, so I'm going to send you this way. Thank God for another way. Y'all, wise men still seek him. Wise people still seek him. And I love what Isaiah, I close with this. Isaiah 55, 6 says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. This scripture, y'all, it implies that there are times where God is found more easily than in other times. There are times when he is closer than in other times. Now, we don't really like that much, but that's what the scripture says. It says, while he may be found and while he is near. Now, we know that the Bible says that he will never leave us nor forsake us, right? So that means he's always present. He's always right there. So what's this thing about while he is near and while he may be found? Y'all, I believe that this is when our perception of him is clear. There are times when your perception of the presence of God is clearer than other times. When your perception of his presence in your life is just, you feel him a little bit more. You know those seasons of your life where you feel like everything is just going great. You feel like you wake up, Holy Ghost. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Everything is just going great. There are moments in time, y'all, it's in those times where things are really going well that you really need to press in.
Yeah.
You really need to press in. You really need to, while he may be found, you really need to fill yourself up. Don't wait for an emergency and then try to do what you were supposed to be doing when it wasn't emergency time. I'm not saying it's not to say that God is not going to be there for you. It's just that it's more difficult during that time. You got these other things. You need to build yourself up on your most holy faith before you need it. I say before you need it. Preparation, that's right. Proper planning prevents poor performance. Amen. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he's near. Glory to God. Glory to God. Don't wait for trouble. Don't let that be you. Seek him now.
Amen.
Seek God now.
Yes.
And verse 7 says, let the wicked forsake his way, the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord. And what will God do? He will have
mercy.
Somebody say mercy.
Mercy.
He will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. He gonna pardon a little bit, a tiny bit. He will abundantly pardon us. Y'all, God will abundantly pardon you. He has abundantly pardoned you, but you've got to receive and believe on him. I want to give you an opportunity. Every head bow, every eye closed in the house of God. For those who may not know God, who may not realize that their sins have been pardoned, your sins have been forgiven, I want to give you an opportunity to come to have a relationship with God. Let that relationship begin today, right now, in this moment. Don't wait. Do it now. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, if you openly declare that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you're made right with God, and it's by openly declaring your faith that you are saved. Pray this prayer with me. Say, Lord Jesus, I ask you to come into my life. I ask you to forgive me and make me new. You said, if anyone call on you, you would in no wise turn them away. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. You prayed that prayer and you meant it. We want you to contact us because you are saved. Your journey begins now. Amen. And you can type in the comments and say, I am saved. You can call or text us at 504-345-8932, or you can email us at prayer@thewholefamilychurch.com. We want to hear from you today. Amen. 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 I said we want to hear from you today. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, you also need to get connected with a Bible-believing church, somewhere where the love of God is shown and it's present, somewhere where you can be fed the word of God. And you might say, I don't know any place like that, but I got good news for you. I'm in a place like that right now. Amen. It's the Whole Family Church. We're located at 3469 Ames Boulevard in Marrero, Louisiana. And we would love to have you and your family come to church. Come and grow with us. You can choose to be a part of the Whole Family Church. Amen. Amen. Y'all, in this day, I told you this. I've been telling you this. I'm going to keep saying it. Y'all, in this day and this time, we need community. Yeah. I said we need community. Amen. We need fellowship. Yes, we need the synergy of camaraderie. We need to be together. Amen. Come on, believers. Yes. We are the body of Christ and members in particular. We have got to work together. Somebody say together. Yes. And so we look forward to seeing those who would come. We look forward to seeing you in the house. Now, if you're not local, you can just follow us online. Keep following us online. We got plenty of videos for you to watch. Amen. But please go and find a local church as best you can, close to the Whole Family Church. Find a local church that will feed you the word of God. Amen. Amen. Come on, y'all, give it up for our online watchers today. I believe God has something for you.
Thank you for coming to church. We are so glad that you are here with us today. If this is your first time, please fill out a visitor's card in the foyer so we can stay in touch. Here's what's coming up at the Whole Family Church. 2023 is not over. Join us for our annual New Year's Eve service, Sunday, December 31st at 10 a.m. with the Brunch Fellowship following service. Get ready to set 2024 on fire with in-person corporate prayer every Wednesday night in January. You may join us here at the Whole Family Church or via Zoom at 7 p.m. But I guarantee you, prayer is better together. And so we're looking forward to seeing you in the house. This concludes our announcements. Have a great week. It's generosity time, and here are the four ways you can give. First, if you're in the house, simply grab an envelope from your seat and fill it out with your gift. If you prefer electronic giving, you can give on your phone through the Church Center app. You can also give online by visiting our website at twfcla.com/giving. Last, you can text to give. Simply text any amount to 84321 and follow the prompts. However you choose to give, we want to thank you for your generosity and support.